good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the planning breakout session. I'm Martin Carter. I'm one of the team of planning barristers in King's Chambers, and I'm sharing this short breakout session with Tony Gill, one of my colleagues from Chambers. I'm going to start off and I'm going to just take you through a bit of an introductory section in relation to officers' reports and the approach to be taken towards them. The first thing I want to tell you is to just sort of put them into context, really. Obviously, the officer's report, in the case of a judicial review that's dealing with planning matters, is going to be a very important document. We seem to spend most of our time crawling all over officers' reports in judicial reviews, treating them with very considerable importance. But the purpose of what I want to tell you this afternoon is to just try and dial that down a bit and put them into context. Obviously, the officer's report is an important record of the officer's reasoning for his or her recommendation to, in the case of a grant of planning permission, because that's what will be the situation that ends up at a judicial review. For a delegated decision, the officer's report will obviously usually be the only record we've got of the decision making process and the officer's reasons for the decisions that he or she came to. And in a committee decision, although the report contains the officer's advice, it's obviously going to be an important piece of the evidential matrix, and it will be a document that also gains central importance. So if we move on to do my Professor Whitty impression, next slide, please, Tony. Thank you very much. The cases have devised a number of principles for us to apply. The first and the most important one, I think, to get across is that we are told that we are not to analyse officers' reports in an overly forensic way. Decision letters from the Secretary of State, we're obviously told that, but it applies in spades to officers' reports. They are to be given a straightforward and common sense reason reading. And the Sirage case and the Zurich Assurance cases, which I've put on the slide, are the sort of principal authorities that deal with that. Secondly, the court will recognise that the planning committee's members have significant local knowledge, so they won't expect an officer's report to describe the area or the district in any detail. They start from the basis that the members have a good working local knowledge of their patch. The court will also assume that officers have a good working knowledge of the statutory test for determining a planning application. That's because members obviously need to have planning training before they should take part in planning committee decisions these days. And so the court will assume that members have got a good working knowledge of the fact that they are to decide planning applications in accordance with the development plan, unless material considerations indicate otherwise. And that's a principle that comes from the Faber case, which I've put on the screen and is developed in a lot of other places too. We can move on, please, Tony. If the recommendation in the report is adopted, so if it's ended up at judicial review, permission would have been granted. So if the recommendation was to grant and that recommendation has been adopted, then unless there's evidence to the contrary, the court will assume that the reasoning in the report has been followed. And that's why the committee report is so crucial, because if the members go with the recommendation, chances are it will be deemed that they've adopted the reasoning in that report as well as the basic recommendation it contained. The report needs to reach a clear conclusion about whether there is development plan compliance, because that's obviously a key consideration in determining planning applications. And so the report should set out whether the proposal accords with the development plan taken as a whole, or whether it breaches the development plan taken as a whole, but in the case of a positive recommendation, there are material considerations that indicate or justify taking a decision otherwise than in accordance with the plan. And I've given two examples in the slide there, the Hampton Bishop Parish Council case and the Tiviot Way Investments case, but the point has its basic roots in the City of Edinburgh and the Secretary of State for Scotland case from 1997, which was one of the leading cases on what was Section 18A in the Scottish Act, then Section 54A in the 1990 Act in England, now Section 38(6) in the 2004 Act in England and Wales. And the key point to remember, when a court is being asked to crawl all over an officer's report and test it for defects, the key issue that the court will ask itself is, did the report materially mislead members in a way which wasn't corrected at the meeting? Obviously, the written report is an important document, but the meeting's taken as a whole. So if the report does contain something that is wrong, officers have the chance to correct it verbally at the meeting. And if that happens, the fact that it was wrong in the report is not going to be crucial. Let's move on to the next one. Minor errors don't matter. The court will not criticise an error if it's minor. It has to have been an error which was material to the decision. And whether the error is material or trivial is obviously a case-specific judgment. So I can't give you any more guidance on that. You just have to form a view on that on a case-by-case basis. One of the other things that the courts are keen to get across is that there is no need for complex and lengthy defensive drafting of officers' reports because of the degree to which the courts are keen to give benevolent readings to officers' reports. And in particular, there is lots of case law that says that there's no need to rehash the background documents. There's no need to go over things in unnecessary detail. Some of the cases actually say in express terms that judges recognise planning committees are busy, officers are busy. They don't expect members to be overburdened with unnecessary detail because, as one of the cases says, if you do that, members just won't read the reports and the background materials carefully. And a good example of that approach is the Hill case that I've put on the slide. That was a case where a planning application was made to extend the hours of operation of some outdoor playing pitches, which were already operating. Both sides, applicant and objectors, had put in detailed noise evidence, wasn't resolved. Council just granted planning permission. Judicial review challenge came in. One of the grounds, you should have resolved the technical noise issue. The judge, who was Mr. Justice Gilbart, later of these chambers, said in terms, no, it's a straightforward issue. We all know what a playing pitch sounds like with people running around playing football on it. There's no need for great amounts of technical evidence. The committee report did not need to resolve the competing technical evidence on that basis. The court will also take account of the fact that members aren't legally trained. They're not judges, and they don't expect the same quality of reasoning for a committee report as you would find in a Secretary of State decision letter, let alone a legal judgment. And always remember, it's not for the local planning authority to prove that their report was error-free. It's for the claimant to demonstrate the specific legal error or errors that they contend were made in the committee report. So the court will very firmly place the burden on the claimant to demonstrate what is wrong with the report. If we move on. There are two cases. There are lots of cases that contain discussion of these general principles. But if you're looking for a good one-stop shop for gaining an understanding of the principles of reviewing committee reports, I would recommend the Luton and Central Beds case, which is a really thorough discussion of the relevant principles at those paragraphs that I've given you there. And then the more recent Mansell case is also helpful in setting out the general principles that apply. And then the final topic I want to deal with just very briefly is what happens if there is something that happens at committee that demonstrates that members, a particular member of the planning committee, says something that may or may not have been terribly helpful during the course of the discussion. And sometimes you will find judicial review grounds that include allegations of what members said and that acted upon the decision-making body. Those things can be worrying for a local planning authority, but in general terms, I don't think you need to be too worried about them if you are a local planning authority, because such claims are rarely successful. Committees obviously comprise a number of people. They act by resolution rather than reasoned decision-making processes. And what someone says in a meeting at some point during it may not end up being the motivation for their vote at the end of the day, because meetings are dynamic. Minds change, discussions progress, people might say something, one of their colleagues might explain why they think that's wrong, and the person who said the comment might have changed their mind and might not actually have taken that point into account at all when they voted in the way that they did. And one of the cases describes that examining transcripts for errors as a hopelessly insecure guide to the reasons for a decision which were taken. And the Poole case, which you'll see on the next slide in a moment, really puts the nail on, hits the nail on the head, I think, and says that at the time a decision is made by a committee, all you can ever know is that at the moment the resolution was passed, the majority of the committee were prepared to vote for that resolution. That's as far as you can usually go, unless things are really extreme. And then I've just on the final slide of my contribution towards this afternoon, there are some useful cases about what to make of member discussions going back to 1915. That 1915 case is surprisingly powerful in what it has to say, actually. So again, if you are in this ever confronted with the situation, have a look at any one or more of those cases, because there are some good passages in them that will help local planning authorities to fight off any challenge that's based on what members of the planning committee said during the relevant committee meeting. That's my contribution. I hope I've helpfully set the scene for Tony to deal with the specific points that he wants to deal with. And I'll turn off my camera and microphone and hand over to Tony.
Thank you, Martin. Good afternoon. Very nice to speak to you all. I'll just note that I've acted in one of those criticising members' discussions during the session type cases for the claimant, and I can confirm, as Martin says, they're pretty hopeless cases to pursue, as I know from being thrown out of court quite firmly on that one, where we did indeed explore in deep what members had said. So there we are. I'm going to be talking to you about some of the areas that we find as key points, key areas of grounds that are key parts of the planning balance that are regularly challenged, and just take you through some references to some useful case law to keep in your toolkit for that basis. It's going to be a lot of case names for you to take some notes of. There shouldn't be any issue at all. I think we're going to have this video online afterwards, and certainly if you want to see these slides, I'm sure neither Martin or I would have any issues. So really take this as a resource in terms of case names to be thinking about when you get pre-action protocol letter through. So just quick headlines. Here we are again with a slide on the interpretation of policy, taking us, let's go back to brass tacks, the 2012 Supreme Court case, Tesco and Dundee. As you know, a Scottish case, but one determined by the Supreme Court House of Lords, and therefore of a binding nature. And that's really telling you about, as you know, the interpretation of policy, that is a matter for the courts, but also, and there's subsequent case law, as you'll know, that Dundee, Tesco and Dundee has been pursued quite relentlessly by barristers since then, that planning policy is not like a contractor statute and should be given, shouldn't be overly legally interpreted. It's the same kind of point that we have about officers' reports, in fact, that as the court has now shown quite often in the last 5 to 10 years, in many ways since Tesco and Dundee, saying, let's just step back from this and remember we're in the world of planning policy and local government, not the sort of more esoteric world of arguments between lawyers. So there's a reference to Tesco and Dundee. And then we have below that a reference to the East Staffordshire case, more recent from 2018, which reminds us again that planning is a flexible judgment-based process. I think you'll all have experienced this often, a specialist report into, say, retail or a specialist report into landscape will have an air of technicality and maybe a quasi-mathematical grids and various other things. But fundamentally, the court's reminding us in that case that we are dealing with judgment and interweaving of different material considerations to come to a judgment. And that's an important point arising from that case. Now, this is a reference for you to the Chartley campaign. This is a golf course case, I'm sure you remember, back from 2014. The original High Court judgment is extraordinarily long and includes various golf jokes. That's what it's famed. That the High Court judgment is probably famed for that more than anything else now, because, of course, it didn't go very well in the Court of Appeal. This is an interesting, gives you an interesting point about the centrality of policy text and the difference and distinction to be made between policy text and the wider glossary justification that one finds within a local plan. So we've given you that reference there. interpretation of policy is often one finds in appeals, but also you will find it in judicial review challenges, that a claimant or an appellant will look to look at the documents that informed a policy or informed the drafting of a local plan provision. And the Fides case, Fides Estate of 2015, is an excellent authority for that, to just take us away again, to discourage, again, I suppose it's the same message again from the court, to tell, to, you know, get rid of the lawyers, stop engaging in overly forensic interpretation. You've had that message from Martin in terms of officers' reports. I've had it in terms of Tesco and Dundee, and here we have it in Fides in terms of looking into background documents. So that's hopefully a useful reference for you. So these common grounds of challenge that I just want to briefly look at, conscious of the time and where it's all gone to. And we're going to look at heritage, which is the expansive ground of challenge and has been expanding for a number of years. You'll note, I think, often with grounds of challenge, they become the ground of challenge of the month, the flavour of the month. Heritage has been on the menu, has been the flavour of the month for quite some time. I think we may be starting to get to the point where we might be getting some really quite firm Court of Appeal decisions that sort of try to put a lid on it. Frankly, I say that, but then again, there's always something new that comes up. Similarly, Greenbelt has always been a vastly important ground of challenge, but one that there's a few cases that I think are worth looking at. And again, at the end, fallbacks, which in my experience have become particularly relevant in the last few years, and I've seen a number of cases coming through. Heritage. So just a few points for you. You'll be aware of this. It was the flavour of the month a few years ago, specifically, was whether or not authorities were appropriately engaging with the statutory chests under the 1990 listed, what's often called the Listed Building Act. And I've given you this full shortening there, the Planning Listed Building Conservation Act 1990. You'll be aware there's two duties within that that are crucial, the 66 duty for listed buildings and the 72 duty as it relates to conservation areas. And what was being run as a lot of challenges was, how do officers' reports that maybe engage with the MPPF and heritage policy, how do they demonstrate this separate freestanding Listed Building Act duty? And that was a very common ground, and indeed it's a ground in the Liverpool case that I cite there. That's the matter that Stanzi was talking about briefly in her presentation earlier. Stanzi acted for the city, I acted for the third party developer. And that was a case where, as Stanzi said in her presentation, the meat of the challenge was lost because the court found that the report simply was insufficient. But in Stanzi's particular point she was making, it went on to be further determined for a wider point of principle on Green Wedge. By that point, my client had left the case because, as I said, the council's report had fallen on the way it considered the relevant test under the Listed Building Act. So there I give you that reference. It's a High Court, the Court of Appeal reference there. High Court was heard by Mr. Justice Kerr, K-E-R-R. And it's just an example of that statutory duty interaction with an officer report. I give you also reference to Mordew that Martin referred to just a few moments ago. In that respect, I look to Mordew because, of course, it gives us this this presumption almost, or I'll be careful using that word, but this finding by the court that where there was sufficient MPPF compliance, there was an ability to read into that there would have been sufficiency to meet the statutory duties as well. And Mordew is a useful case for considering that. But we also have this Wyeth Price case from just last year that's a slight development of that, which I bring to your attention, which is about, well, yeah, but if you don't follow the MPPF process properly, then you obviously can't follow the statutory process properly. To take that point on board, you really need to be sure that the MPPF has been followed properly. So a couple of heritage cases there. Let's just move on. You'll be aware within the MPPF of we have different brackets of heritage harm, substantial harm, less than substantial harm, and then no harm. Interesting case here from Bradford from 2019 that makes the point that, unlike so often in planning where we might talk about, oh, this is a de minimis issue, we don't see such a categorisation in heritage and we shouldn't read one into it. If there are three categories following the Bradford Hall case, substantial harm, less than substantial harm, and no harm, we shouldn't be trying to insert from our experience as people working in the field of planning some concept of de minimis in this particular area of the law. I then have given you reference, and it's a very short reference to a very long case, the Bramshill case, which is most recent in the Court of Appeal decision. Bramshill, you may be aware of, probably not by its name, but by some of its facts. This was where an inspector had to deal with dozens of different appeals in relation to the redevelopment of a police training college, at which was involved a heritage asset and involved the key issue in terms of policy interpretation is about the policy as it relates to isolated dwellings and what does isolated dwelling mean. But why I bring it to your attention is that, as so often nowadays, it's a great case for summatively bringing together areas of policy, statute and case law. I'm sure, I hope Martin would agree, but what I've certainly noticed, particularly in the last 10 years, is a real trend, presumably from judicial training, to seek to write, certainly in the Court of Appeal, but often at High Court level, judgments that pull together tests, pull together a case law and give a really tight account of them. So we have Mansell, which I'm going to be talking about briefly later, and which Martin's already talked about, which does a superb job, I think, and people rely on it now regularly in that area of officer report law. Well, similarly, Bramshill is the latest attempt from the Court of Appeal to seek to lay out what the heritage parts of policy and law are doing. And for that, it's an excellent read. I'd like to say that's the last word on it, or one would hope, but these things are always changing. And in that regard, I just bring to your attention, hot off the press, as it were, that we've just heard today, or it's become apparent that the Gardens Trust have lodged a JR, or have been given permission for their JR, to challenge the Holocaust Memorial appeal, where permission was granted for the Holocaust Memorial in Westminster Gardens. So that is proceeding. It has paper permission, I understand it. That's proceeding through the court system. I think it's highly likely that that's going to result in another significant case and perhaps a very significant judgment. So there we are. You can see this constant turnover of big cases coming through. And finally, on this page, I refer to the Dill case. This is just an interesting area. This is this rather sad case about a gentleman who sold two large lead urns from his garden that he, in fact, his family had moved to the property in the first place. They weren't original to that garden, but they were listed. And in fact, unbeknownst to him, he hadn't realized there'd been a listing process. And in doing so, he had sold them and they'd left the property, and therefore he had breached the listed building provisions. What was interesting was there's a substantial argument about can essentially a very large plant pot be a building, and it's not something that's determined in the case. The Supreme Court sends it back, but it certainly says, well, applying the tests, for instance, Skerritts, which you may remember, Skerritts, there's the potential for it, and so it gets sent, remitted back down. But that's Dill, just from last year. Greenbelt, I've just drawn attention to a few cases you may be aware of. The Samuel Smith's Brewery case that has been is the leading case on Greenbelt currently, Supreme Court case. About a quarry in North Yorkshire. I draw that to your attention. And whilst it's very important about the interaction of visual impacts as a component of openness, it's of course another one of those more recent cases that says, but again, we're looking at planning judgments. Please, lawyers, stop elbowing your way into the court with these things. I think that's a theme that we're certainly getting from the planning bench and from the Court of Appeal. I next refer you to the Mayor of London case, which is an interesting parallel with the Mordew case, which is essentially saying, if it's clear that the decision maker or the report has engaged with the MPPF to some degree, you shouldn't need to expect every single dot to be joined within, for instance, in this case, Greenbelt policy. I'll take you to two cases about exceptional circumstances in the plan-making process, Keepbourne End Green and the Lloyd Coilert investment case. Both about exceptional circumstances. In the Keepbourne End Green, it's again pointing out that what exceptional circumstances is a planning judgment. Yes, it's a phrase that has gained great weight because it's there within policy, but it is a matter of planning judgment, which I suppose harks back to what Martin has been saying earlier, to not get too worried when you're trying to protect an officer's report, because you will be remembering that we are engaged in a judgment of a specialist area. Lough Coilert is about a beautiful village just south of Bath. This was a case where a neighbourhood plan had a local green space policy that sought to do more than the Greenbelt policy did, because the locals felt that their local planning authority wasn't doing enough to protect their countryside. So they tried to insert in a policy that was more demanding than Greenbelt policy. And the court simply said, well, you've not shown why this policy is justified. We're not going to allow you to create a sort of Uber Greenbelt within your neighbourhood plan. And then a couple of more Greenbelt cases. Sefton MBC over on Mersey, about how one goes about a Greenbelt judgment. There was an argument that there was a sort of articulated judgment that had to be placed on two stages, and putting upon the council or putting upon the Secretary of State in that case, because it was a statutory challenge, how they should go about their Greenbelt judgment. And again, you see, I think the court again saying, stop trying to mandate and make too legalistic a planning decision maker's judgment. And that's what I think we can draw from Sefton. And then we have the co-op case, which is a challenge by co-op to the grant of consent for an Aldi. I think this was Miss Bell as well, in fact, with Paul Tucker acting. I think perhaps for the interested parties. Again, this is an issue about, again, the court asserting what are matters of planning judgment and not law. And so when you're looking at an openness judgment, and there are different factors that can inform that openness judgment, you have a planning judgment to make about the factors you rely upon, and you shouldn't be mandated by a claimant coming through the legal process. And finally, fallback is the concept I want to talk about. Here we have a slide that refers you back to the Ahern case of 1988, which is an older case, but it's a useful starting point to remind us what fallback is. And it's taking us through the existence of an alternative option that is a fallback. It's telling us about the need to apply the test of, well, if it does exist as a matter of fact, is it a true fallback in that it is a realistic prospect, which we are told from case law is something that's not simply a probability, not a likelihood, but merely a realistic prospect or more than merely theoretical. And then finally, if the answer to that question of realistic prospect is yes, then it's the engagement in a comparison. And that's something I've noticed, particularly in recent years, that there's a lot of people having to maybe retool a permission they've already been granted through a Section 73 or something else, who therefore have a fallback that they bring to the council in an application, and that council is going to have to deal with that in a report. And you're going to have to be careful about how you deal with fallback and how you address it. As I say, I noted that the Michael Mansell cases from Tunbridge and Malling is the leading case right now, or so far as it is the excellent High Court of Appeal authority that lays out the case law history and talks about the principle in a really readable way. So it's something I'd again recommend to you if an officer needs to think about fallback, even before the report's, you know, at a final draft, say, well, actually, look at this. It's very readable. It's very useful. And I also take you to the Stockton-on-Tees Luna case, which makes a simple but very useful point of saying, again, to us lawyers, don't over-fetishize this concept of fallback. It's just another material consideration. If you find it's material, then obviously the matter of weight for it as a material consideration is for the decision maker. Stop, you know, trying to create clever little cul-de-sacs for lawyers. And then because, as I said earlier, fallbacks are so often engaged with Section 73, I've just given you that reference to Finney, which is a useful case from 2020 in terms of what a Section 73 can do when it gets brought in. So I've just given you as a little palate cleanser at the end. So that's a bit of a gallop through, but I think that's the nature of the exercise we've had today. Hopefully those slides will help you. I'll just take us to the end.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you for your time.